Vaginal discharge is very common, though it might seem different at certain times due to certain factors like pregnancy, ovulation, the use of birth control pills, whether you're sexually aroused or not, or just dependent on the phase of menstrual cycle you are in at that particular point in time. However, it is important for you to know that the consistency, the color, or the smell of your discharge could be a red flag. That is, it is pointing out at the presence of an existing infection or the presence of an underlying ailment. So, in today's video, we'll be looking at the different colors of vaginal discharge. You get to find out what is normal and what is not normal. Also, you'll be finding out the appropriate diagnostic test you can use to find out what infection is giving you that particular color of vaginal discharge. Also, we'll be finding out all the basic lifestyle changes that you can inculcate or implement in your daily lifestyle in order to reduce or minimize the risk of having an abnormal vaginal discharge. Hi everyone, my name is Emeles Nonye. Welcome to this channel where we discuss everything reproductive health and women's health. So is this something you're interested in? Please hit on that subscribe button and let's get started. So, the first color of vaginal discharge I'm going to be talking about today is the yellowish-green vaginal discharge. This is completely not normal and indicates the presence of a sexually transmitted infection. An example of a sexually transmitted infection that gives off a yellowish-green vaginal discharge is the trichomonas vaginalis. This is a parasite that is gotten when someone has sex, unprotected sex, with someone who is infected. Some of the other symptoms of this infection include foul smelly vaginal discharge, burning sensation while urinating, painful intercourse, and itching in and around the genitals. And it is important for you to know that men are asymptomatic, that is, they present with no symptoms, and this could explain why they could go on infecting their sexual partners even without knowing it. And pregnant women are most likely to transmit this infection to their unborn child. That is why it is very necessary for you to run all your antenatal tests and run them on time, because early detection could save your unborn child from getting all this infection being transmitted to your unborn child. Treatment is by the use of appropriate antibiotics, which is going to be prescribed to you by your healthcare provider. And while treating yourself, it is very necessary for you to treat all your sexual and past sexual partners, all you have met even within the last 4 weeks. It is very important for you to treat your sexual partners so as to avoid reinfection. And during the course of treatment, it is very necessary you avoid sexual intercourse even up to 1 week after your treatment. All right. Another kind of infection that produces a yellowish green vaginal discharge is gonorrhea. The almighty miserial gonorrhea. I call this almighty because if not detected early, or if poorly treated, or if left untreated, could result in complications. And some of these complications include pelvic inflammatory disease or pelvic inflammatory disorder, and equally scarring in the fallopian tube. And the resultant effect of this is infertility, that is, difficulty in getting pregnant. And this infection can be quite tricky in the sense that it presents with no symptom in women. Most times it doesn't produce any symptoms. You won't notice any symptoms. The people that even notice symptoms are the men in this case. And some of the symptoms include, of course, the yellowish green vaginal discharge, burning sensation while urinating, pelvic pain or lower abdominal pain, bleeding in between period, sore throat, and fever, amongst other symptoms. Treatment of this infection is by the use of appropriate antibiotic, which is going to be prescribed for you by your health care provider. And it's important for you, anytime anyone is treating a sexually transmitted infection, to treat alongside a sexual partner or partners. And this is to do what? Avoid reinfection, so that once you treat once and for all. Another kind of discharge we'll be talking about is the red or the pinkish discharge. This could be normal and it could also be abnormal. This is normal if you experience a reddish discharge just before the start of your next period. This could be an indication, my lady, the next period is about to start. Just get ready. Are your pads not yet around? Please make sure you get one. Yes, that is when it can be normal, in the sense that it is telling you that your next period is about to start. It could also be normal if you're experiencing delayed period. Just maybe your period is late for about 2 to 3 days or up to 5 days, and then you have a reddish or a pinkish discharge. This could be one of the earliest signs of pregnancy, as it's called implantation bleeding. It could be telling you that pregnancy is about to start developing. It's not your period, it's important, and it could be one of the earliest signs of pregnancy. All right. Also, it can be abnormal when you notice a red or a pinkish discharge in between your periods. You know, you just finished your period, or you finished your period about 5 days ago, about 6 days ago, and here you are, and you know that it's not yet time for you to start expecting your period, and you are having some spotting, you're experiencing some reddish or some pinkish discharge. In this kind of case, it is abnormal and could be a pointer to something that might be going on there, and it is the right time for you to see your doctor, because whichever way it is not a good sign. It is either that it's telling you about a miscarriage or something else. So bleeding in between periods is a red flag. You need to see your doctor. Also, in postmenopausal women, you are no longer seeing your period and all of a sudden you're seeing reddish or pinkish discharge. This is equally a red flag, and it is not something you should treat at home. It is the time to go see your doctor, because it could be an indication of an endometrial cancer. And then the grayish kind of vaginal discharge. This is not normal. It is an abnormal kind of vaginal discharge and is an indication of a bacterial infection known as bacterial vaginosis. Yes, it is not a sexually transmitted infection, but the risk of having bacterial vaginosis is increased once one is sexually active, and it is caused as a result of bacterial overgrowth. I already listed in my previous video some of the implicating or some of the causes of bacterial vaginosis, which includes distorting the normal pH balance of your vagina by some acts such as douching and use of scented products and perfumed products and all of that that causes irritations. Once you do all of this, is bound to distort the normal pH balance of that area, and you come down with an overgrowth of the good bacteria that is found there. And treatment of this is by the use of the appropriate antibiotic, which as usual is going to be prescribed by your healthcare provider. The symptom of this infection is usually a strong fishy odor. It presents with a fishy odor. Your vaginal discharge is going to be having this fishy odor, and then itching, then the grayish discharge. Though sometimes it could be asymptomatic too, but when you do get symptoms, it is as already listed. And then the white or thick white kind of vaginal discharge that is usually described as cottage cheese in appearance. This might seem normal, but once it is accompanied by itching or a kind of unusual smell, then it is thrush. Thrush is vaginal yeast infection or vaginal candidiasis, and it is usually treated by the use of the appropriate antifungi or antimycotic drugs, and even the suppositories or pastries, and equally the creams. Your doctor knows just the right one to prescribe for you depending on the severity of your symptoms. And some of the symptoms include already this thick white vaginal discharge that is cottage cheese in appearance, and equally vaginal itching, and perhaps burning sensation while urinating, and probably painful sex, but does not always occur. And then what is normal? Yes, there is normal vaginal discharge. Normal vaginal discharge is a little bit whitish or creamy and watery in consistency, though certain factors as stated earlier can increase the quantity or the volume of this vaginal discharge. But however, you're supposed to know that there is no point in time that a normal vaginal discharge is going to cause you to get a sanitary pad in order to control the wetness. All right, so normal vaginal discharge is clear white depending on the phase of menstrual cycle you are in. If it's around the time of ovulation, it could get thicker, slimy and slippery, looking like raw egg white. And you're supposed to know that it doesn't present with itches, it doesn't present with foul smell. Yes, we all know that there's a way the vagina smells, which is not unpleasant. You're not supposed to present with unpleasant smell, just a light, creamy, watery kind of vaginal discharge. That is what is considered normal. All right, so what are the appropriate diagnostic tests that you're going to use to pin down the cause of your abnormal vaginal discharge? The first one is your urine, both urine analysis and your urine MCS, that is microscopic culture and sensitivity. In the case of a trichomonas vaginalis, it is a parasite and does not require culture. So once you produce your midstream urine, I've already explained the meaning of midstream urine in one of my videos. A midstream urine is a sample that is required by microscopy. Careful microscopy of your urine sample, you can see the multi trichomonas vaginalis doing their jerky movements in the urine sample. Also, urine MCS can equally be used to detect some other kinds of bacterial infection. Even your yeast, that is thrush, candid, vaginal candidiasis, yeast can be seen in urine microscopy. The quantity, how heavy the infection is, can be visualized microscopically. And then Neisseria gonorrhea, the almighty Neisseria gonorrhea, like I stated earlier, the appropriate or the most sensitive and specific test to dictate this is by nucleic acid amplification test, which is called the NAT. It's a very sensitive technique that dictates this bacterial DNA as they are. And then ECS, endocervical swab, can equally be gotten. Once you get a swab sample of the patient or the individual that is coming for the test, and you can visualize this, culture it, and find out some of the implicating bacteria that could be giving you abnormal discharge, itches and all of that. Oh my God, I don't even want to imagine. All right, so what are some of the risk factors? What are the factors that predisposes you to having this vaginal discharge? Man, you need to make some basic lifestyle changes. Is that something you can do on your own that will make sure that this thing is well taken care of? You don't continually come down with this. Yes, one of them is by what? Personal hygiene. I already made a video here where I stated the right way to wash your vagina. If you don't wash your vagina the wrong way, you're not going to have yeast infection that is caused as a result of distorting the normal pH balance. Even if you do get it, it could now be as a result of other causes, which I'm still going to be stating. So wash your vulva the right way. Wash your vulva the right way. Maintain appropriate personal hygiene. That is one. Then practice safe sex. Safe sex is not all about pregnancy prevention. I'm on this kind of contraceptive, I'm taking this emergency contraceptive, you're in this and you're on that. There is also safe sex that keeps you away from sexually transmitted infection. Pregnancy is not just the main deal. Yes, you've prevented pregnancy. Have you prevented sexually transmitted infection? And this can be achieved by using a barrier method, which is condom, C-O-N-D-O-M-S. Use a condom. It's going to prevent someone that is not aware they have an infection, or someone that wants to purposely infect you. I mean, by the use of a physical barrier method, you're not going to contract that infection. And the right kind of underwear to wear is wear loose fitting cotton underwear. This is going to make sure that the area is aerated, and not wear nylon underwears that will retain moisture and kind of make the environment very friendly for these organisms to grow and thrive. Wear loose fitting underwears that are of cotton fabric is going to go a long way in making sure that you don't retain unnecessary moisture in that area. So vaginal discharge can occur alone or accompanied by other symptoms such as vaginal itching or burning sensation while urinating. In any case, it is important for you to know what is normal and what is abnormal so that you are going to know the right time to seek medical help and seek it on time. So it was my pleasure staying here to chat with you. Please, if you have any question, what do you think about this video? Is there something you want to add? Please put it down in the comment section and it will be my pleasure to respond to all your comments. And until I come your way again, I remain your favorite. Thank you, and I'll see you again.